Don's a little Dawido. My name's Donnie Squirrel. I'm with the Community and Cultural Outreach at the Cherokee Nation. And this is part of our second Tuesday evening cultural webcast. And so thank you for coming. Thank you for being here. It's a nice day. And so it's good to have sunlight when we're meeting now outside. So got through the winter. So that's good. I want to start with
My name's Donnie Squirrel. I'm with the Community and Cultural Outreach at the Cherokee Nation. And this is part of our second Tuesday evening cultural webcast. And so thank you for coming. Thank you for being here.
Where's Kevin?
It's a nice day. And so Kevin. It's good to have sunlight when we're meeting now outside. So got through the winter. So that's good. I want to start with
My name's Donnie Squirrel. I'm with the Community Cultural Outreach at the Cherokee Nation.
April Fools.
April Fools
is not just a day now, it's a whole month. Okay. See you, Nagad. Again, thank you all for being here. And we have a great presenter tonight. Of course, they're all wonderful. They're national treasures, but we're very happy to have our presenter here tonight. I'm going to introduce her in just a little bit, but I want to make a couple of announcements. There are a couple of people would like for you to keep in mind. Community and Cultural Outreach works with a lot of communities at the local level and at large all over the country. And so our communities, we're pretty connected to so many and so many people. We get to know so many people. Like for you to keep the family of Newton Spangler in your prayers. His wife passed, so they're from the Brushy community. So please keep them in your prayers. Vicky, the wife of Newton Spangler. And of course, last week we lost a living treasure, a national treasure, Edith Knight, a talented woman. And fortunately, Kevin spent a lot of time with her this last year and captured just many of her talents and who she was as a person. So we're very fortunate to have that work documented as well. So please keep her in your thoughts and prayers as well. Thank you all again for being here. I'm going to go ahead and introduce our speaker. We're very fortunate to have Betty Christy Frogg with us this evening. Betty Christy Frogg was born to Lacey Christy and Louise Ross Springwater and has two brothers, Calvin Christy and the late Harvey Christy, who was younger, and one sister, Barbara McDaniel. And it's a small world because I've known of Betty for a long time, but she just made all these connections to where I grew up in Kenwood. And so, you know, we're related. Mm-hmm. And so, and as y'all find, as you move around different communities, you'll find that even in our at-large communities, everybody's related. She has four children, three sons, Ronnie Joe Hale, Adam Hale, and BJ Frogg, and one daughter, Annie Hale Kimball, and one stepson, Jackie Frogg. She is the grandmother to 10 grandchildren, seven girls and three boys. She has taught her daughters and granddaughters and grandsons the art of basketry. She is bilingual, and Cherokee is her first language. She also makes corn husk dolls, twined bags, and moccasins. She was designated a National Living Treasure in 2011 for basketry. She has been making baskets for about 30 years. She learned to make single wall baskets from Bertha Alsine and double wall baskets from National Living Treasure Lena Blackbird, who also was a treasure for basketry. She learned flat reed basketry from Shauna Morton Kane, National Living Treasure. Baskets have always been her passion. Gathering traditional reed has always been fun for her. She loves being outdoors. She says, all of this is work, but it is something that I enjoy. She has taught basket making in schools and communities for many years. She received her bachelor's degree in education from NSU and is currently teaching second grade at the Cherokee Immersion School. Please welcome National Treasure, Betty Frogg.
Uh-huh. Bendiciones, God. I brought a couple of my baskets that are round reed, but first we're going to talk about the gathering. There goes my honeysuckle. Ran off. Like that was mentioned, Donnie mentioned, that I do love being outside. I like sitting outside to make baskets. So I was raised playing outside, like many of you were. Playing outside, playing with sticks, not behind the computer, not behind the PS, whatever they call it, not with the iPad, but we were creative with how we played. We were creative because we didn't have anything. And during our romps outside, running around in the woods all day, we had creeks. We hunted crawdads. We hunted onions and poke and cochani. We did all of that. You know, our kids, my grandkids do know because I've taught them. They love hunting crawdads. They love being out in the woods. But they still go back to the iPad. But Kevin followed me around, what was it, a couple of weeks ago, Kevin? Followed me around. I thought, I don't know if I want somebody following me around. But really, it's really good to have at least one person with you when you gather, because you never know, you know, you can get tripped you up gathering the vines and stuff. Thelma, you probably know that.
They love just being out in the woods.
You know, I asked Kevin, I said, what's going to happen if I fall? Are you going to keep filming?
But, he said yes.
Kevin followed me around, what was it, a couple of weeks ago, Kevin?
But, Kevin asked me a lot of questions
while I was gathering.
I don't know if I want
and
somebody
as you can see,
me around.
A lot of these, but really, you try to gather the longest ones you can find. And
you never know,
you can get
these are
up,
some of these are at least 6 or 7 feet long.
Thelma, you probably know
and
that.
What they are, there's not the actual plants. A lot of people think we gather the plant. We take it off of the plant.
Kevin's Facebook.
Thelma and I both know we gather the runners on the ground, and they're copper looking, the copper color. You look down, you see it, pull it, and sometimes it's really long, sometimes it's not that long. And right here's a good shot. You can see the live one, you can see the dead one. And that's just the way it is out there. And it may have been, we gather between after the first frost and before the last frost. So. Like I said, a couple of weeks ago, you can see the difference between the live and the dead. All of this was alive, but like I said, you can see, I had to pass one around so you can look at it. If I can find one without this one. But as I gather, I just roll it up and keep going. Of course, I had Kevin and his wife helping that day. But all of this has been rolled up and it's dried out. Dried out now, and after it's gathered, I just like roll this up, let it dry out a little bit, and after that, find me my big pot, fill it up with water, build a fire outside, stick this in the big pot, just let it boil. And once you let it boil, and you check it to see if the bark is coming off easily, then you know it's ready to take off the fire. After it's taken off the fire, let it cool off. Get you an old washcloth, towel or something in your hand, and just grab it.
Stick this in the big pot, just let it boil.
It will come right off.
And
once
you
let it boil, and you check it.
Almost the same color
as the
if the reed that you can buy at the Heritage Center is coming off easily.
There's a big difference.
Honeysuckle
then you know
kind
it's
of
ready
and
to
shiny
take off
looking,
the fire.
Whereas the commercial
after it's taken off the fire, let it cool off.
So I'm going to pass this around. This is a honeysuckle. And a lot of people, when I first started making baskets, nobody really told me the difference between the commercial and traditional. That's something I learned just working with people like Thelma, Lena, Bessie. But the traditional reeds, they're rough, but they're shiny, and they're rough. You can feel it. If you take the commercial basket, it's all smooth. And I'm, in my years of basket making, I have seen commercial reed passed on as traditional, which I do not like at all.
But I'm going to pass these around, let you touch them, feel them, feel the bumps, feel the knot, feel the smoothness, the shininess. You can tell the difference. And that's what I like for people to know.
If you take the commercial basket,
there is a difference between commercial reed and the traditional reed.
And
I have seen
store honeysuckle
for quite a while.
Commercial reed passed on
that some
that was boiled last
I do not
last
like
spring.
At all.
Which is
but I'm gonna pass these around, let you touch them, feel them,
you can
feel the bumps, feel the
you
knot,
can
feel
save
the smoothness, the
smaller portions,
the
like this right here is really small.
And that's what I like for
and
people to know.
The commercial basket is a difference.
I mean, we don't throw anything away. If it's long enough to make a start, we keep it. Anybody ever attempted to gather honeysuckle? No? You have? Yeah. I know. That's the bad thing. People want to get rid of honeysuckle. And the honeysuckle, people say, hey, I got honeysuckle on my place. And I think, great, where are you? And usually it's way off where, I don't even know where it's at. But I would love to find some honeysuckle that wasn't growing on a fence line, you know, just like freestanding out in the woods. You can find it, because that's where I got most of this stuff. It was out there at the Echota Stomp Dance Grounds, David Cummendeers, which I had permission to go out there and gather all I wanted. But if you can find stuff like a place that you see honeysuckle, ask permission to go out there to gather. And I will be glad to help you gather and show you how to strip it and everything, because I enjoy it. This is fun for me. Weaving a basket to me is fun. It's relaxing. Better than the second graders. No. But it's just slick, and it. If you gather it the wrong time, and when you weave a basket, it's going to be flat. It'll turn flat. But if you let it dry out, like this has been drying out after we gathered, there's going to be no better
problem with it going
graders.
Flat.
No.
Sometimes you can find a honeysuckle basket. But
you look at it, it'll be kind of flat
it's
where it's been woven.
Slick.
But if you gather it the right time,
and it's, it.
Do the right
if
things,
you gather it the wrong time, and when
you
weave a basket, it's going to be
a non-gathering time.
It'll turn flat. But if you let it dry out,
but
like this has been drying out.
Any questions so far?
We gathered. There's going to be no.
Just weaving a double wall? It just depends on the size of basket you're going to make. And also, I think like everybody starts their baskets with 6/6, some cross. So we have six across 6/6, and then we start weaving. And for a bigger basket, you have to add spokes into it so it won't be wobbly. Because when I was working with kids in the communities, they would make bigger baskets and be so proud of it. Then when they set it down, it'd go flop. But you have to have extensions in the bigger baskets. You you add extensions onto each side of the spokes you already have. And there's two ways to weave. After you add the spokes, you can use a single weaver or you can use a double weaver. If you use a double weaver, you add spokes to every one of these spokes that's already in there. But if you want to use a single weaver, you do not add spokes to one, if that makes sense to you guys. Does it make sense? Thank you. Thank you. Each basket, tricky basket, is started with 6/6. And then we add the seventh one in. And then the seventh one is our weaver. So like 7 is a lucky number on the Cherokee people. So when we weave, we add the extensions in it to make a bigger basket. This is where I'm saying you can either put extensions in all of the spokes already there and use a double weaver, or they call it chaser sometimes, but I just call it double. But if you want to just use a single weaver, you do not add extensions to to one of them.
You can see on here, talking about here's the main one.
Mm-hmm.
You can see the one that's there.
Yeah, you see the V's? You see the V's on there? That's where the extensions have been added. That's how, it starts out with a single weave.
Yeah.
And then we weave up as high as we're going to go, or how, you know, how big we're going to go, and then bring down the second wall,
yeah.
And it ends up down here, and the bottom is a single weave. Now, you see the V's?
There is
see the V's on there? That's where the extensions have been added.
That is woven all the way. You start at the bottom, you end up at the bottom.
It starts out with a single weave. And this is one of my passions here. Sue brought me these baskets because I really didn't know what I was going to be doing. I thought I was going to be talking about gathering honeysuckle for 30 minutes. I thought, how can we do that? But anyway, flat reed is my passion also. And there is a double wall basket the Cherokees made that is double wall. You start at the bottom, you end up at the bottom. You cannot tell where you start and stop. And from my understanding, these double wall baskets like this with a double wall lid were basically used for urns. Because at one time our people were actually buried into the ground. They were cremated. So the ashes were stored in these baskets. But buckbrush, honeysuckle, split white oak, river cane, very traditional reeds. We use traditional dyes with our traditional reeds. I've not been out to look for bloodroot. I don't know if the rains, we didn't have enough rain to produce enough bloodroot this year. Kind of sparse, really sparse, because I haven't found any. Have you found any? Have you? A little bit? Oh, really? Well, I'm not going out there. They're already gone. But walnut, shavings off the men's bow making in the village, I usually get a bunch of bow dart shavings. That makes a really pretty yellow. It's kind of a brownish yellow, where the walnut is from a light brown to a dark brown. The bloodroot is anywhere from a kind of a reddish orange to a yellow orange, to a really pale looking yellow orange. The traditional colors is always used on traditional reeds. Now, I have seen people use traditional colors on commercial reed, which that just rubs me the wrong way. It does. I'm like, why are you wasting your hard gathered stuff on commercial reed, dying commercial reed? You can use berries. You can use pokeberries. But, you know, those seem to fade out real quick. They don't stick with their color. I don't know if the mordant that we use or what, not using enough mordant to keep it that same color, but they seem to fade within time. They'll have no color. But walnut, bloodroot, bowdark, they're all good. Those are my favorites. Now, gathered river cane, that's not one of my least favorite. I usually don't gather, I just split it. Now, river cane is one of the meanest materials you can work with because it'll cut you. When you split it, it'll cut you. When you weave it, you get cuts. But they make beautiful baskets. And those can be dyed with the bloodroot and the walnut. Walnut was very abundant last year. I had all I could use from the village. I can go to the village and say, hey, I need some walnuts. Or I dye stuff while I was there. And while I also worked in the village, I did a lot of dyeing. I dyed a lot of twine to make twine bags. But I had people come and say, would you dye this for me? Which I would, no problem. But if you have any questions so far. Mm-hmm. Yeah, pokeberry is kind of it's a really pretty color. It's kind of a pinkish purplish. But it takes a lot of them. It takes a lot of them. And like I said, I've not ever really used it that much. And there is, you know, like when you color Easter eggs, you use vinegar to make the color stay. But there's a lot of things that our people used to use.
And one of them, and when dying, one of them used to be a young man's urine. That was one of the things that was used in dyeing, like walnut and other stuff, to keep the color. But as far as the berries and stuff, like I said, they're beautiful colors. But they don't stay, so I don't know of any kind of, you know, what they would have used that for that. Now, I've heard salt, but I think I tried using rock salt one time. It did pretty good, but it just seems to fade. For some reason, it will not stay. The pokeberry? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Any questions? Yes. Mm-hmm. Actually, we'll just I just take the whole dried out hickory nut, walnut, and just put a bunch in a big pot, just boil it. And then during some time while it's boiling, I start taking them out, then I start adding my whatever it is I'm dyeing, whether it's reed or twine or material. I start adding that into, and at least some at the bottom. And that's my way of dyeing. I don't know if other people do it that way, but that's kind of, you know, I just use the whole thing when it's dried out. Because you know walnuts will really stain your hands. So that's one of the best ones that you can use. You know it's going to stay. Like when I put this in a pot, boil it, strip it, then I'm going to take some of it out and dye it. And then I will just store it till I'm ready to make a basket. The process of making baskets is really long. One of the questions I used to get, one of the questions I loved when I was working at the village, was how long did it take you to make that basket? I'm like, do you want to know from start, like when we gathered, when we dyed it, when I said, I don't know. And you know, my answer was always, I have never timed myself. I never saw a reason to time myself and how long it took me to make a basket. Thelma, did you ever time yourself? I always tell them, I have a family. I have to cook, I have to clean, I have to, you know. I said, when some of that stuff's done, I go make my basket again, work on my basket. Something comes up, I leave it, I go do that, I come back until it's finished. So timing, I don't know where that came from. I have no idea where timing came from. And it just kind of blew my mind. A lot of these people from out of state, when they'd come to the village, that was their question. How long did it take you to make that? Do you time yourself when you do stuff? I mean, if you're enjoying yourself, there's no way you're going to time yourself. No way. You're having too much fun.
Tell them seven generations.
I'll remember that next time.
You know, Betty, I'm not a basket maker. I'm not making masks. That's why I admire everybody so much that can make things. But I used to, we had a lot of basket makers there,
mm-hmm.
including my Cherokee. We'd go to different places and sell baskets.
Mm-hmm.
And people would ask that question, how long does it take to make mm-hmm. a basket? And I would say it could take up to a year depending on the dyes you use, because mm-hmm. those dyes are in season at different times
yep.
of the year.
That's right.
So if you have a basket with all three of those colors or four colors that
you waited.
Yeah, you've mm-hmm. you've put a year into yeah. that basket. So they are very precious, precious things. So.
And I always liked it when people come to my basket classes at the Heritage Center, because they got a taste of what it was like to make a basket. Even though it was a small basket, like that basket right there, looks like one of the ones that we started at the Heritage Center. It was a 18 by 18, something that they could finish in 6 hours. Mm-hmm. And they got an appreciation of what it was like to make a basket.
Yeah.
And they knew, and even though they might have thought our prices were outrageous, they had a deeper appreciation
yes.
in basket making. And I would hear women come up and say, hey, I did not know it was that hard to make a basket. Actually, it's not that hard, is it? When Thelma and I are basket makers, so we don't think it's hard. Yes. I have never thought basket making was hard. Mm-hmm. It was just like second nature, you know. Mm-hmm. And it's just like, I tell this to some of the people too. I see a basket before I make it. I know that sounds strange. And some people say, no, it doesn't sound strange. But I will see the basket I'm going to be making. And if I try to alter it a different way, it does not turn out. It will not work. But you go back to the way you saw it in a dream or just, you know, visually, you know, you visualized it, you go back, it works out beautiful. One of the baskets that I'm talking about I made that way was that big, the gathering basket that's at the museum here at the Heritage Center. I had seen that. You know, I had, for some reason, it just came. I thought, I got to use walnut. No one used bloodroot. So I used those. And it took me over a year to make it. It took me over, because the base of it is about, I can't even remember, but it comes up rounded. And I wove leather at the base where it, before it curved up, as to where I could strap it on my back as the gathering basket. And that was one that took me a long time. Basically, when I was trying to finish up, I got sick. We all know how it happens, you know, I don't want to do that. But I got sick, and about 2 or 3 months later, I got to looking at it. I thought, I got to finish that. So I finished it before, not the Trail of Tears, but the homecoming show. I finished it. I entered it there. Didn't win nothing, but it sold.
How many different plants do you use for dyes?
I use walnut, bloodroot, and the shavings off of a bodock tree. When the men make bows, I get the shavings from that. So those are the three colors that I use. Those are the three colors that actually really stay.
What color is the bodock?
Kind of a yellow looking.
Mm-hmm. It's also called a yellow locust.
Oh, okay. Well, I know.
Oh, sage orange, and what else is it called? Horse apple tree. Horse That's apple my tree. Favorite. I like that. I grew up with it being a horse apple tree. And the shavings, are very small. Just put them in a pot, put water in it, let it boil. You can even go ahead and put your stuff in there while the shavings are in there, depending on how big your pot is. So if you want to go dye, go to a flea market, go to a yard sale, find you a big steel pot. This is what you'll be using. Find you a big steel pot. You can build a fire outside. You can dye. You can boil your reed. So if you live out in the country, it's easy to do. I don't know about living in Tahlequah, but but gathering, like I say, gathering baskets, all that is my passion. Any other questions?
Is there a way to save your dye, or how long?
You can put it into an empty gallon jug, but it's not going to be as strong as it was. But you can reuse it.
So you can use it until it's up, or does it just last?
I use it until it has no color. I use it at least 2 or 3 times, depending on what you're dyeing. If what you're dyeing is light, then it's going to take on color. But if it's a little bit dark, like twining material, stuff like that, it's going to take a little bit longer. You know, but you can use it more than once. Mm-hmm. So if anybody knows where any bloodroot is, let me know. Walnuts, I can find. I got them all over my place.
Do you ever freeze your dyes?
Do what?
Do you ever freeze your dyes?
I have heard, Shauna used to tell me she froze her bloodroot. They used to gather a lot, and they would put them in gallon bags and freeze them. But I've never done that because I never found enough to freeze, just enough to use for my use, you know. Lily pad. Lily pad.
Oh.
Lily pad. But it grows along the sides of creek banks, like on the sides of the hill. Imagine climbing the side of a hill and sliding back down and climbing. It's fun. It really is. But they look like they have white flowers. And then when you, yep, there it is. And they're using the root. So you're going to be doing some digging. And it kind of resembles a mini sweet potato. Or a micro sweet potato. They're about that long. If you break them in half, they bleed. Really pretty. It bleeds. Beets. I have heard of beets, but I have never used beets as a dye. Have you? And there.
If you use the bloodroot and take the root, does that mean the plant will die and it won't be there again?
Yeah. That's why we, when we gather, we don't gather everything we see. We leave some.
You can kind of see right there what the roots are red.
Right here. Can y'all see that? Or just my finger? But no, we take care of nature. That's how we were raised. We take care of nature. Just like gathering honeysuckle, I've heard people say, well, if you gather that, are you killing the plant? No, we're not killing the plant because we're gathering the runner. The roots are in the ground. These are just runners. So no, we're not killing anything. But see? That right there? It's like a little sweet potato. Yeah. You take it and you pop it and it'll bleed. That's why it's called bloodroot. It also has medicinal purposes. They used to use it for blood thinner. But that's what that is, bloodroot. Because everything that we know is everything that was taught to us. All have different uses for them. I use it for dye. Other people use it for medicine.
I had heard that the Iroquois actually use it for war paint. Do you know?
The bloodroot? I have no idea. I just know Cherokee. I'm being around from Ader County, Cherokee County, relatives in Mays County. I have never really been around other tribes, really, just Cherokee.
Once you place that in your dye, how long do you boil it before it takes the color on? I know you have probably watch it, but about how long do you boil it?
After you place the reed into the dye?
Uh-huh.
I just keep watching it and see how it's taking. Just like I do walnut. If I want it darker, I'm going to let it boil longer.
Okay.
And same way with the reed. If you want it darker, it's going to stay in longer. No, it's not a matter of minutes. I wish it was a matter of minutes. Especially by the time you get things going, you are anxious to make a basket and you want to hurry up and get. But no, it's, I would say, 2 or 3 hours.
Okay.
2 or 3 hours, the max.
Now, how long do you have to let it dry before you start actually making, after you dye it?
After I dye it?
After you dye it and do you let
I can
it,
actually start using it.
You can start using mm-hmm. it right away?
Rinse it off really good. Just place it down, go to your natural color, start weaving, start adding your color.
So does it not dilute it when you have to wet your basket again?
Uh-uh. Mm-mm. No, because you have rinsed it, just like commercial dye.
Okay.
You have to rinse it and rinse it
okay.
and rinse it, you know, or it'll run. Uh-huh. And it just makes a nasty looking basket. But once you get it rinsed, where it's not running anymore in cold water, you're fine. The difference a bit with the round reed and flat reed, round reed, everybody keeps them in water, which is really totally unnecessary. It's totally unnecessary. Just get them wet. Don't soak them, you know? Don't get them so soaking wet. But it's used to make it pliable where you can weave and it won't break. But flat reed, it's totally different. I don't care. You can soak it for a little bit and start weaving the bottom. then after you get going up, get your spray bottle and just spray it. You don't soak those in water. You don't just dunk them in water like I've seen people do round reed. And the natural material, split white oak, split hickory, split ash, you don't soak those in water. You just get your handful of water and run your reed through your hand to get it wet. Then you weave with it. Now, river cane, you can soak in water. But even to work with the split woods, just running, putting a handful of water and running it through to scrape it down to the thickness you want. Of course, you'll do river cane the same way, because river cane's not exact after it's split, quartered at least one time. When you pop it off to get the outside of it, there's gonna be a little bit of the core of the river cane. You're gonna get a knife and scrape that off to where you want, where it's pliable. Any questions? There's Bodart. That's one of my favorite colors. And it's the shavings. The guys will save the shavings when they're making bows. If you need some to dye, you can just go to the village and say, hey, can I get some Bodart shavings? Don't know what you're talking about. Give you a bag full, and you got something to use for dye. It's a beautiful color.
So I noticed that the honeysuckle is a tube versus commercial reed mm-hmm. is like a solid core.
Uh-huh.
So does that make it more difficult to work with?
The honeysuckle? The honeysuckle is very easy to work with. Very easy. In fact, it's probably easier on your fingers than this one is. Because for one thing, this is rough. It's not rough, but like you said, it's hard. And honeysuckle, if you let it dry out, it doesn't go flat, it's round. It's easier to work with. It's not as rough to handle as this is. I've gotten blisters working with this stuff before, especially when I had to order like 50 some odd baskets this size for a banquet. You end up with blisters but honeysuckle is very easy to work with as buckbrush. Buckbrush is thick like a number three reed. I don't have three. Number three reed is a little bit thicker, more coarse, and that's easy to work with than the commercial stuff. Commercial reed, when I first started making baskets, was very cheap compared to what it is today. It was like $5 a bundle, with your pound bundle, $5 less. And now it's like $13, $14. Like, wow. So go out and gather honeysuckle. Make traditional baskets. But I would not use traditional reed in teaching children baskets. Never. And I love it when I used to do baskets in schools. They'd call and say, Betty, can you make baskets? We got fifth grade, we got 40 kids, we'll give you 20, da 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 da. I say, okay. And get there and they'll say, I know how to make a basket. I made that before. I'm like, really? Where'd you learn? Oh, you were here last year. I'm like, okay. I said, boy, I must have been good. They said, but I know how to make. I said, okay, show me. And after that, it was like, you know, they didn't know how to start a basket. Of course, when I teach baskets out in the communities, I make starts for the younger ones. And when we make starts, all they have to do is unravel it, stick it in water, and start weaving. And I said, hey, if you know how to make a basket, you can start it and finish it. I said, can you start it and finish it? I said, you cannot call yourself a basket maker unless you can start it and you can finish it by yourself. It was like, shock. They're not a basket maker. I burst their bubble, I'm sorry. But teaching baskets to me is fun. I usually don't go any lower than fifth grade, except when it comes to my grandkids. I've got young grandkids, young granddaughters that are excellent basket makers. They come to my house, we open up a table, we make corn husk dolls, we make baskets, we do everything. I sit at a table. And my grandson won first place in the county fair with a flat reed basket. So I was like, all right, my grandson. But, yeah, we have fun. This is fun stuff for us. Yes?
When you run out of your honeysuckle and you got stopped, how do you start the next piece of honeysuckle where it kind of blends in?
Okay, if it stops on the inside, you always stop on the inside. Like this is the spoke, stop on the inside. And then the other one's going to come in just like this on the inside. And you won't be able to tell, especially if you're doing the inside wall, you start them on the outside. But when you're doing the outside wall, you start them on the inside. I know I got you confused. You never see where you start and stop. It looks like one continuous piece going all the way around. Yes. The berry of the poke.
Oh, let's
get that. Mm-hmm. See
what's in the
hue? Zaide. Utana.
Utana.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. That means the berry of the poke. Oh, stop. Kiloka jalegu wani isti uduli. Tony Nihena. Tony was one of my kids at Peavine School. I worked at Peavine School for over 16 years. Tony and my son are the same age.
Is he and the reason you quit working there?
Don't tell anybody.
Still,
no, he's a good kid. Good kid. Excellent kid. Good kid. When he was in the eighth grade, he wasn't quite that tall. Seeing him at Walmart, I don't know how many years later, it was like, wow, because my son BJ was the tallest one in the eighth grade class that year. He was tall. And now it's like everybody's up here and he's down here. So. Okay, this is commercial reed, so this is commercial dye. So I hunt for it at Walmart aisle on laundry detergent. Yeah, you can get any color dye you want on when you go hunt for it at Walmart. You can also mix them just like you would, you know, colors to get. You can almost get colors that are close to traditional. Mm-hmm. Close to traditional, not traditional.
Is the yellow or is the other one natural?
There is no natural colors here. These are all commercial. There is no dye on my honeysuckle basket here.
So there's only actually three colors you can use for traditional?
Or no, you can use traditional colors besides the ones I like to use. Those are the ones I like to use.
Where do you get the dye for some of those others?
Which one? The natural dyes?
Yeah.
Like pokeberries. Okay. Some of them use the mulberries.
Okay.
God, I can't think of the name of that.
But they're just not as color fast.
Yeah.
As the rest.
I can't think of that plant. In Jalek, it's called Kaloek. It has these red looking berries all bunched up. I can't remember what it's called. You can use that, and it's kind of a brown color that would turn out about the color of this. It's sumac. That's what it is. You can use those. I've never tried huckleberry. That's a waste. I eat those. You don't waste that. It goes. There's other things that you can use for dye. I've heard people using red onion, but I've never used red onion myself. I've heard, the purple onion. I've heard people using stuff like that, but like I said, I tend to stick with the three that I name. And Thelma, do you do the same thing?
Yeah, I have tried the yellow thing in husk,
light yellow. There is a, I used to have a little booklet that told the different plants and what color you could get. You had that book too, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Walnut
dye
to see what happens. I haven't tried it.
You haven't tried it? I just tend to throw the walnuts in and just boil it.
If anything, you'll end up with tetanus.
Don't drink it. Is it walnut? It smells nasty. It smells nasty. So you don't want to do it in your house. Do it outside. It smells like owl house. Worse than owl house. Yeah, if you want to do stuff like this, find your place, make a fire pit outside. Do it outside. It's fun outside. You can sit out there. And I've had, when I was teaching baskets at Skelly School, we used to bring hot dogs, roast hot dogs while we were boiling honeysuckle and, you know, conversation, good conversation and stuff. But yeah, it's a good place to get to know people, the people you're working with, and teaching baskets to. Yes? Yes, I would. This is Thelma Forrest, my friend Thelma. She's a basket maker. She's one of my mentors. She's the one I say, hey, how do you do this? Thelma Forrest. She and I are going to be working on a project for CCO. Right? Yeah, we're going to be making some mats. I think they're going to be about this big. Any other questions? Statements?
What sort of pot do you dye in?
Stainless steel. One of the other dye that pot that I used was that porcelain, the black porcelain, that white dots. Yeah. That's good. But you can't really find them really big, like the canning. You know, they're using canning. That's good if you're just going to dye reed in it. But if you're going to boil your reed and strip it, you need a bigger pot. But if you're dyeing a bunch of reed, that big pot's good.
And a big canner.
Yeah.
Water bath canner.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or one of those inside of a wash tub. You can use that.
After you take a bath.
That's what Kevin does. But there's a lot of things you can use. There's one of my friends, I don't know if you guys know Victor Wildcat, works at Fort Gibson Schools. He made a big pot he welded together. It was about this big, square, had legs, built a fire under it. This is where we made ball sticks. We stick all wood. And I turned them. That was one thing I left off. I can make ball sticks. I can make blowguns too. But he made that big pot. That was great. I used it at Skelly, you know, when we boiled a bunch of honeysuckle and bug brush. I used it there. And like I said, it's a good place to roast weenies. Marshmallows too. But it was fun. And still is.
Six on six, what do you mean by that?
This is going to be like teaching my second graders. Listen now.
Hey, I'm too old to be that sharp.
Okay, six. Six, see, 2, 4, 6.
Uh-huh.
2, 4, 6. And there's actually six here, but the one when I started, we had the seventh one in here, and then the weaver is going to be the other seventh one. That's where the seventh one comes in.
Hmm. Okay. Okay.
Horse, could you?
No.
That means, do you understand? Those who don't speak, that means, do you understand? So I tell my second graders, "E Josh Gus," they'll go, "Uh-huh." They'll say, "Kelly." "Uh-uh." They're fun, though.
Betty, do you like to work with the buck brush, too? Or is it?
I love to work with the buck brush. I love to work with all the natural materials. Basically, because, like I said, it's fun to gather. It's fun to get it together to where you can work with it. It doesn't really take that long to get it to where you can actually start weaving baskets. Buck brush, the only difference between buck brush and honeysuckle is it's a little bit thicker. It's like a number three reed. This is a number two here. You can get all kinds of gauges in commercial reed. You can get some that's about the size of tree limbs if you. But one of the best, one of the neatest things I've ever seen was a baby bassinet made of buck brush. And that was made by a lady from Kenwood.
Ella May
Black Bear. It is beautiful. It was like this big. And she even had the cover on it. It's in the museum. Is it in the museum?
I'm not sure.
I've seen pictures of it. But it's gorgeous. Mm-hmm. It's a double wall. And you think, oh, my God, she gathered 2 years for this thing. But it's beautiful. I'm like, whoa, I'd love to have that for my granddaughter. And she's like 5 months old now. But it's beautiful. It's a buck brush. I mean, it just amazed me when I look at. But if I go to a museum, hey, you'll find me where the baskets are. You'll find me where the baskets are. If I go to antique store, yard sales, I look at baskets. I'm like, commercial. But you know, sometimes you can find some really good stuff. You can find my Aunt Shirley. She gave me a river cane basket. It's about this big, had a handle on it. She got it at a yard sale. She got it for like $3. I'm like, yeah, I'll take it. But she finds stuff she thinks I might use for a pattern, which I do sometimes. But I tend to stick with the traditional patterns of the flat reed. And round reed, you can go round and round and round and round. That's one thing I always thought was, you know, all you do is go round. Because my sister and I used to sit and watch TV and just make baskets. But there's really not that much you can do with a round reed. There really isn't. But you can put designs in it. You can put a checkerboard pattern. You can alternate it, make it the colors go down, like that basket, diagonal. You can add patterns to it, but that's going to take a little bit of time because if you add the patterns to it, you're going to have to cut, insert. I've seen that done. You've seen that done too, right? And I've seen Bessie. She made a chief's daughter in one of the baskets that she made, and it was cut, clipped, and, you know, stuck in, but you can't tell. You couldn't tell, but that's the way it was made. Now, you can do that in twining, too. You can do the double twist in the twine bag and make the second color pop up to make the diamond. But that's one thing I've always been, if I see something that's traditional that I want to learn how to make, I'll learn how to make it. And that's always been, stuff like that has always come easy to me. A couple of years ago, or over a year and a half ago when I was working at the village, because we always had to make our own outfits, and made the leggings and needed moccasins. Tim says, Noel, he's known as Noel. Tim, he said, this is how you do it. Measure your foot, da-da-da-da-da, do this, do that. And I'm going, okay. But I thought, oh, my God, I never learned how to size moccasins. So I made a pattern. He said, make a pattern. He said, make it out of cardboard so you can keep it. It'll last longer. So I made my pattern. So I've been making moccasins ever since then for other people that have asked me to make them. So I learned how to measure. I've even made my granddaughter moccasins. They're about that long. They're so cute. But I used the softest elk that I could get on hers. But moccasin making was something I wanted to do. And the 1800 traditional dress, the wool skirts, tray shirts, I wanted to learn how to do that. I can do that too. So anything tricky that I always want to learn, I can learn it. So you can.
brush, do you use the stem or do you use the root?
Use the same thing. You look for the different color on the ground. Just gather, look at the ground, see the copper color, pull it up, long scissors, clip. Same thing, it's like honeysuckle, no difference. Gathered the same time as honeysuckle. And like honeysuckle, it will go flat if you gather at the wrong time.
And what was the time frame to gather?
After the first frost and before the last, which is a pretty good size time frame. You can gather after October, after the first couple of weeks in October, usually when the first frost, start gathering in, which is a good time to gather because you don't want to be gathered when the snakes are around.
Ticks and chickens.
Yeah, ask him. I've never heard that, have you? Because buckbrush usually grows along fence lines, tree lines. It usually grows through there. And if there's anything that's in the field, it's going to be a cow or a deer, you know. And oh, you mean breaking it up by walking on it? Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
I've heard it creates knots, too, but I've seen knots. Pretty too.
Yeah. in fact, the knots in buckbrush are a little bit heavier, thicker, like there's knots in here. You can see those knots in the buckbrush is going to be just a little bit thicker than what's
more character makes you know that it's real.
Yeah.
Not commercial.
And that's where you can tell the difference between the smooth is commercial and the rough is traditional.
I'm sure you have the differences and similarities between our baskets here and then the Eastern band, kind of their styles and materials.
Yeah. Okay. The round reed baskets, honeysuckle, buckbrush, all that didn't come around till after the Trail of Tears. That came about after the Trail of Tears. The flat reed baskets have always been the baskets because baskets were used for everything at one time. Whether most of the time it was flat reed, they used it for storage, carrying their babies, fish traps, everything that they wove from a basket style was always used. Storing, gathering, burden baskets. But this only came around after the Trail of Tears, and I really don't know where it started. As far as the double wall, I know the double wall was made so the basket would last longer. It was tough, but that I do know that only came after the Trail of Tears when Cherokee settled here. But they still made flat reed baskets because they still used baskets. They used hickory, mulberry, the tree hardwood trees here. They split it just like the Eastern band split theirs. But they always say women are the basket makers. Actually, no. There was a man that lived in Mulberry. I can't think of George Forkiller. He made beautiful hickory baskets, flat reed. Beautiful. They were just plain, just like this. You know, we put color in ours, basically, because we can sell them to tourists. You know, I don't like to sell too many of my baskets. I'm like, they're mine. No. But baskets with handles, they carved the handles. George's baskets were beautiful. They were huge. Because they used them for laundry baskets, they used them for, you know, they were used. They weren't set up on a shelf somewhere to be admired. They made their baskets to use. In carving, I don't think I'd
I've tried carbon handles. Not too bad, but... I like to learn things for myself. If I see something that I need to work to make my baskets, I'll learn. I want to learn. Any questions? No questions? Did I put everybody to sleep? Just like my second grade. No.
I think if there aren't any questions, I think we're right at 7. So unless you want to do some closing remarks.
Well, thank you. Well done. Galieli.
Well, no, Betty, we learned a lot. I haven't heard somebody talk about all the different dyes and those sorts of things in a long time. So it was good to hear that again. Thank you for sharing what you know with us. And also, Thelma Forrest, thank you for being here with us. I was just quite surprised and happy when I saw you come in. So thank you. Maybe we can call on you to teach us something too someday. So, okay.
I should have said, come here, Thelma.
Okay. Wado again, Betty. Wado. And thank you all for being here. Appreciate it. And we'll have another one next month, and we'll let you know what that is, and give you all that info soon. Wado.